And I'm delighted to be joined by Michiko and Koji. And just to kick off, I would like to invite Michiko, if you could briefly describe your practice for people who may not have visited APT and how it engages with architecture.
Yes, thank you for your introduction. Firstly, I want to introduce myself very shortly. I born in Japan, I'm Japanese, and I lived in many places. I lived in the US when I was small, and I moved a lot of times, like more than 20 times in Japan. And now I'm based in Kanazawa, which is northwest part of Japan, which is a great city. My first background is engineering, actually, not art. And then I found that I'm not suitable to engineering. And I studied a lot shortly about the architecture, and I was interested in, but I didn't take the path to be the engineer or architects. But I found myself as an artist, and I started. And about very shortly is that a bit. But the most of my creativity, creation, is related to the existence of the camera. I'm not very trained as the any of the painting or sculpture, making sculpture, but I just except for cameras and except for videography. So the basic medium for my expression is a camera. And then I'm strongly inspired by not the subject of the camera. I'm more interested in the progress of the technology of cameras form or the existence of the camera. And then now you see this image of my installation. It's very old work for me. It's like I've been showing this work like more than 10 years, but I still finding itself new. And this is the third time in Tokyo, the gallery for new media. And it's not in exhibition space, but this space has a lot of people passing from many direction. So I was very careful to organize or manage those frames where to hang, this work is as you see, there is many frames. Actually, it has 12 frames suspended from the ceiling, and some has mirrors inside. Some has screen inside, projected from the projection, and some is empty. And then there is a camera, and then the real time image is projected on the screen. So there is like a rewinded mirror. This time I was very concerning about how the people moves, how the people comes from, how the people, the way of seeing, which to see or which to move. And there is some galleries in this direction. So I was thinking the people to stay more in this space to explore the work, and then don't want to say please join or kind of instruction, So the people, if they come to this space, they will find themselves or their friends in an unexpected place. So they will start to search. Then they will be included. That's my way of playing with space in this work.
Wonderful, that's great. And perhaps we could jump over to you, Koji, to give a little brief outline about your approach to practice, but also your approach to space.
Thank you for having me today. My work, in my work, I'm interested in just the materials around me in my everyday environment and the form that they can take and possible interaction or experience that they can create. So I went to the art school in Sydney in the late 90s. And at the time, I think a lot of traditional techniques was not so available for me to pursue in such an extended sort of way. So I actually do not have any specific medium that I'm comfortable to work with. So my inquiry always starts with what can I use and what can I do with them? So in that, I often use found objects, and I'd like to create a speculative form in a sort of improvisational way, working with chance, spontaneity, to the point where it starts to possess another narrative life or sense of life or space of imagination. And I come from, I suppose, an animist background, so my work is not always representational, but I just like to present the work so it gives a sense of life and whatever that might be or whatever the form it takes for the work that I'm working with. For me to create the work, I think not so much just an object, but the space it possesses is very important, and that becomes the work itself for me. And also, the experience it can create and interaction that it can allow and the time that it captures is really important for me. So I can't separate my work and built environment or the work that the space that work is installed in. And I think I need to work out the ways to bridge the gap between the objects in the space or the work in the space. And I think the work then bridges the gap between the space and the audience. So I'm just trying to sort of see how that relationship could work so I can create this one environment which seems. The approach I often take is to embrace something in the space and then take that into the work somehow and then spit it back to the audience in a kind of playful or perhaps uncanny way. I'm often interested in, I suppose, non-heroic or incidental features of the architecture rather than major, sort of, I suppose, heroic aspect of the building. This is a work that I did in collaboration with another artist, Anna John from Sydney. And we were working with found objects and also the lights or the image or moving images that that are projected to the object. So this was very experimental, and we were just sort of trying to work out or play with the relationship between the volume of the work and what could happen with the surface and the perception of the object and how that could change. I thought I would include this work because It's quite different to my work that I usually make. I don't have any moving images or not so much kinetic element usually in my work. But for this, we installed the work in a pavilion at the Bondi Beach, where it is a lovely space to work with, but often the formal work does not quite work in the space because it, you know, it's just right next to the changing room, and the audience would come not really expecting to see the work, see the show. And also physically, you know, you can't really hang anything on walls. And there are so many features in the space that are like light rails or hanging rails that are quite distracting in a way to introduce work that relies on subtlety. So what we did was actually decided that we would like to play with those features. So we videoed the space. So we were just kind of took a video of the space, so moving fans in the space. So in a way, the space was kind of doubling and multiplying, but then gets slightly distorted through the objects that we put in between. So this was kind of a bit open-ended projects that we did. And due to the heavy rain back then as well, I feel like maybe 10 people saw the show. Gave us quite a bit to think about in the future works. And that was a bit of a significant moment for me. And I'd just like to show another example of the work that I've been working on. I've been interested in working with domestic objects, especially vessels and glass glasswares. And I've been testing to see what I can do. Initially, I made instruments with those works because that was the very immediate way for me to engage with the materials, but also to occupy and activate the space. But this work is a second work where I just wanted to make something that a bit more formal and static. And I'm not gonna go into too much about the work here, but when I got given this space, this is actually quite a difficult space for me to work with because it's a lovely space at the bottom, in the basement of the art gallery. But as you can see right in the center, there are four pillars that are very dominant. And whatever the work you put in has get kind of divided between those pillars. So instead of trying to do something against it, I just again wanted to embrace it. So what I did was I asked them to make the plinth in the same scale as the pillar because they kind of just look like a big plinth that's holding this ceiling itself. So I just wanted to use that and then incorporate that in my work. So in a way, it just kind of becomes the what's in the space is multiplying, but in a way that it doesn't usually. But that allowed me to, integrate the work in a space to come together to form a formal environment.
I think what's interesting, particularly about this piece, but also your practice in general, is sometimes you take these awkward moments in the architecture of the museum and they become the basis for the work and it really animates it and gives it a structure. And so with that in mind, is there an ideal space to show your work? Because sometimes perhaps like, or is a kind of very blank gallery not as interesting for you because it has less to play with?
To be honest, I was actually quite bummed with this space and also Bondi Pavilion initially because it's not what I expected and I didn't really have that kind of things in mind. But those strong characters can, you know, overpower your work, but somehow by working with it, you can make something interesting. So it's always a negotiation between the space for me. So I'm not sure if I can think about any ideal space. I mean, I actually quite like to work with, difficult spaces that gives me something to play with. Now I actually really love this space. So just took time. And also working in a studio, I just couldn't really see how the work would turn out at the end. So it was a bit of a nervous process for me as well. And just responding to things as I go as well. So, but also with this work in particular, gave me a way to play with this idea of formal work or formal relationship between the plinth or the base and the object, because that's how things are usually presented, but I could put something underneath the base as well, just to sort of animate the space a little bit. And as you can see there, like for me, the first inquiry making sculpture is how they are standing or how they're holding themselves up. So just having those really basic inquiries as a ongoing thread really helps me to work through the inquiry. I wouldn't like to call it a problem, but inquiry. So this is where I've been. Then the work I produced for GOMA for APT is an extension of or follow-up to this installation.
And before we go there, maybe we'll jump back to Michiko to ask, your work often both responds to the architecture of the museum, but also creates an architectural space. So is there an ideal space for you in which to show your artwork?
Yes, I want to show another previous work, which is you would have gone there to see them by then. I always use this kind of long sentences as a title. And I made this work for IT Triennial, the last one, the 2019 in Nagoya. The venue was called Ito Residence, which is very old house and very good house, built in 300 years before in Edo period. And then this space itself has a very special air. Like I felt it's a very special space. So I don't want to put my artwork to just to see my work. I thought of this space to the audience to stay this space or to see this space more. So I this is the first time for me to think of the borrowed landscape, which is Japanese, in Japanese we say shakke, the borrowed landscape, the idea of gardeners to borrowing the existing landscape as their work. So I thought of this space itself as the landscape, and I kept myself as minimum as possible. So I took the size of the frame from the architecture and the space of the, that gap between the screens, also taking from the architecture itself. So I, for this space, I didn't, it's 10 o'clock in Japan, so my clock sings 10 times. Sorry, it's always happens. And it's the extension of my previous installation I showed in earlier. But this time, until then, until this time, I was taking the distance or the how to organize is almost decided, but I decide some gaps. So, but this time I kept my, how do you say, my ego or my myself as minimum as possible. So the width of the frame as well, I didn't decide. Just everything taken from the architecture, and I thought that it's, how do you say, it's more creative. And then it much as urge people, urge audiences to engage with this space. So this is the another example. And then after, can I talk about the work?
Can
I talk about the work of APT? Fortunately, I couldn't be in the space. I couldn't visit the Brisbane yet. So
quite a new way of working for you as someone who's responding to architecture, and yes, then all of a sudden not being able to be present. Yeah.
So the process with the curator, the Ruben, always doing the virtual tour with mobile phone, and it really worked, and that was really great. I'm so happy to engage. I think it's engaged with the space, and then we did a lot of, how do you say, discussion, the many exchange through the floor map, and then it worked. I did two space. I made an installation for two space, and one of them is this. Both are not in a gallery space. One of them is the it's close, the space close to the entrance, and then also the in between the bathroom and the cinema foyer, so the people passes from many places, and I was interested in the stairs and the maybe the elevators in the other side, and when Ruben talked about the space, the particularity of this space, I thought that it's interesting to include the mixture of the people from coming from many directions.
And
so
the space, because people are going to escalators and into different spaces, or into the cinemas, or into the toilets.
It's not often
a space that people stop.
Yeah,
and we don't often have a piece of artwork there. Perhaps you can talk about what happens in that particular artwork.
The work in cinema for you. It's the title is Triologue, which consists from three frames. One is empty, one has mirror inside, and one has the transparent screen projected from both sides, and there were also two cameras capturing the empty frame from the both side, and the one is 1 minute delay. So and then both images are projected on one screen. So the cameras facing each other, and then their images are merged on the screen, but 1 minute's different, and the direction is different. So it makes confusing, but it has something similar, but different. So that's the thing I wanted to do. I want
often
to
when you were
audience
around.
It too.
Because you were down the escalator, but you're already in front of the artwork.
Yeah.
So it has that confusing sense of time in it as well.
Even
as
though you are there, you will find yourself in another place. So, and 1 minute is like short memory has gone. But you still remember part of it. So I found it interesting to play with 1 minute. And another one is in River Lounge in upstairs. It's facing, I love this space, even though I haven't visited since I'm interested in the skyscraper in Brisbane. So I want to, be closer to this view. So and happy to be showing this work here. And this one has also three frames, one empty one, both mirror and the screen inside, but different organization, or different, how to say that all.
It's in a more linear pattern rather
than different pattern or different arrangement. And the camera is based, they are parallelly settled. And then the distance is also same as the distance of the window. And then the mirror is on the space, in front of the pillars. And I also take the distance or the colors as well, the architecture, the space itself. And then this time, one camera is facing towards this way, through the empty frame, and then it's projected to another one. It's very simple arrangement. And
delay on that?
Delay once in an hour, very shortly, but you can see that yesterday for 1 minute.
And this is a space that people walk through more slowly than the other one.
Something different, similar but something different. This time I felt like it's the combination of the previous works, and then communicating with the space particularity. That's the way of, that's the way of playing with, or that's the way of engaging with. And then I hope it's success. And then, Sonia.
Yeah, I think it's very successful. Maybe we should turn to Koji to talk about his work in APT before we jump on to other questions.
Thanks, Ellie. I mentioned about my work having a main inquiry of how they are standing or how they are placed in a space. Departing from my last work, which were placed on floors using plinths, I just wanted to try what I could do to lift them all off the floor and install them all on walls. And it's just a simple, again, shift in how I approach it, but that did open up a lot of things I could try. I was able to, just using that framework, I was able to bring in a lot of materials and small ideas, series of small ideas that I've accumulated in the last few years or decade. The actual space itself, I was hoping for transient kind of a space where there's a bit of a movement in a space. I thought that might resonate nicely with my attempt to create a little bit of a stable space where my work can go on. While I work with a bit of spontaneity, and I like to embrace the work to embody some kind of movement, especially perceptually, the act of sculpture making for me is to create a temporal sense of permanence in how the objects are placed, and in almost like in a similar way to how the traveling birds would create nests on walls. So I just wanted to sort of create those platforms. And I did work with a basic system where there's a shelf that goes on walls and there's something on it. And then there's just something else that's placed on it. So it's still working with a similar formal kind of approach. But in some cases, the objects are actually underneath supporting the shelf. And there's a bit of a play in that relationship as well. I loved this space. I was so grateful that I was given space. It's such a beautiful space where in this modernist building where so many different materials and different spaces intersect at this point. From the wooden floor to the marble and stone walls and floors, there's a bit of a fountain on the other side. In one side, the sunlight would come in. It's just a very dynamic space. And in a way, because of it, it's also is an intimidating space for me to work with as well, but because of it, in a way, the space is already so rich in materials. The materials in my work can be fairly poor and cheap, and a lot of them are actually, the stuff that I found discarded, or even some of them were, in them being on the streets. But I was hoping that kind of conversation or dynamic that are created between the materials and objects are able to echo this very heroic moment of the architecture. The title, Citadel, came sort of halfway through the work. The citadel means, the fortified center of the city or the small city. And each work having some kind of coherent relationship within it or environment within it, I thought it's a nice framework for me to work with, but without, again, trying to represent the idea of citadels, that the idea of the citadel became a little keyword or even the lens to view the work, my work through. So it's applied as an idea rather than this architecture. For me, I kept thinking what that then could mean to me. And these days, the citadel, I was thinking, could it be the house that I live in? Or could it be the share house that I live in? Or could it be just my body? Like, I was just trying to sort of think through that. But also, while I was making it, came lockdowns, and our houses somehow became a fortified sort of center in a way. But also the shift in how I perceived our everyday shifted a little bit, and everything that felt familiar was no longer familiar for quite a while. And friendly neighbors also somehow became a threat, because they could all be giving us, giving each other viruses. And that sort of turning perception towards our domestic things, somehow I thought might resonate well with my use of domestic objects, which somehow turned unfamiliar to possess imaginative possibilities and possible poetic narratives. So, at the end, I didn't really find the answer for that. And all the shelves were created is fairly quick and improvised, and it's actually just a few different planes intersecting. And it's just about to locate this point where you can sit on the walls. And in a way that I thought would speak well with, again, so many materials intersecting in that space. As you can see, there are so many pieces, there's no one, there's no center. And also it's installed in a way that there's actually the actual center of the wall is somehow left blank as well. So for me, that repetition of making each work became almost like absurdist exercise of trying to get somewhere, but never being able to. But that process itself becomes very rewarding. And I'm just hoping that kind of process that I enjoyed is somehow still embodied in the work. It's totally up to every audience to engage, how they engage with my work. And I'm aware that some people just walk past, not even recognizing it. But for some people who would like to invest a little bit more time and attention into work, I like my work to be rewarding by offering things that they could discover as they go, whether if that's a hidden object or could be a little empty space somewhere. I'm looking forward to going back and see the work. I haven't seen it since the install. I usually don't get to see my work that much, because install is when the work comes together. And there's only so many times I can go back to see my show. Just looking forward to spending a bit more time as well.
And I think it's perhaps more obvious in Michiko's work, the way that the viewer's body is central to the practice. But could you also talk about how the viewer's body, becomes important in this particular work? There's such tiny little changes and textures and details that you kind of get up close, but then it's also more than 7 meters high and spanning, almost 20 meters. And that's also a kind of reoccurring idea in your practice.
Definitely. Thank you, Ellie. So my scale of work is often determined by the object that I use. So they're all domestic. So they are all kind of, quite small, and they don't usually function that well, or they do appear alienated in big spaces like institutional space or industrial spaces. So my approach somehow has to, address that and somehow subdivide the space to create the moment where it can be. Sorry, my internet says it's unstable. Can you hear me still, Ellie? Did I freeze? Okay.
Yes.
Is to create the moment that allows more intimate interaction and viewing from the audience. So for me, again, the height is very important, and how they see the work. I can only go from my height. Obviously everyone has a different height and they would see my work in a different way, but I think for this work the viewpoint is important, and also I quite like the way some work are a bit hard to see because they're installed so high and becomes kind of a bit of a I'm hoping that it becomes a bit of a mystery, but at least a bit of a question to see what that might be. Just because I'm just hoping that space will offer a moment of curiosity by people trying to figure out what's going on. So, but also from not so much the body, but from where they're located, I'm hoping that composition would offer a different viewpoint and how they overlap. So therefore it can create different, aesthetic experience or dynamic between objects.
Thank you. And Michiko, we might go back to you to ask that question. You know, you make these incredible spaces that are so often responding to the architecture and make people aware of the way that they move through the space. I mean, is that a hope for your practice that beyond just seeing your artwork, that viewers might go and look at architecture more broadly in a different way and in a more attentive way?
Good question. And very inspiring talk from Koji about the center, about not having center. I was thinking about that, and maybe I'm also thinking of how to escape from center, or how to not to making center, but I use the center, but make that not centering using center. Maybe that's the thing I'm doing with architecture. And then another thing I'm thinking with the architecture is like not to see just the artwork, just that the my installation hope to work as a device to see more detail or see more the different aspect of the architecture to find another, another aspect or another, the expression of the architecture. That's what I think about with the space is my work. But I want to think of the discussion. Oh, sorry, my internet is okay, but I want to think of the discussion about the center more, not only now. Thank you.
And it would be nice to hear kind of more broadly what you see as that kind of relationship between art and architecture. Mm-hmm. Do you see them as quite different disciplines, or is it a more kind of porous practice for you?
Porous. Yes. I think it relates to the previous discussion. I'm making the border blurring the audience and the author or audience and other audience or the audience at the camera. I make it confusing and then make it blur the border. And I also started to do performance in my installation, and then that's also making it blurring the performer and audience and myself and other people. Like, so it's not like the theater, like it's not like audience and performer, it's more mixing. And also, I'm not trained as the performer, not professional dancer or the performer, but even though the performing and being natural is like very, not easy to categorize. That's not the bordering I'm concerning these figures.
Great, thank you. And Koji, was there anything that you would like to add about that relationship between art and architecture? I mean, as someone who teaches in an architecture department, perhaps.
That's such a big question, Ellie. And I know that there is a bit of ambivalent relationship between architecture practice. Actually, is such an interesting field. So without, you know, you embrace that or not. And I can only talk about that through my own work and my experience. But for me, I love working with spaces, but by introducing things like little dust or fur or garbage, or bringing your eye to get used to seeing something that are very subtle, I'm hoping that then people start to notice things that they didn't notice before with the space. And those features might not always be what was intended by architects initially. I mean, it could just be a little crack in one corner or a little spot that's been filled by you know, like some kind of glue, or could have been anything, or could have been just the garbage on the floor. But I think that's also is a part of the enjoyment being in the space. So, you know, like I just would like to, you know, approach that in a very endearing way. And even when I work with a space that's hard to work with, or initially I didn't quite know what to do with, I like embracing all the features and architecture. So